My name is Ulrich Hinsberger. I'm a violin maker based in Biberach, south of Germany.
My name is Piotr Pielaszek, and I'm a Polish violin maker based in Poznań, in Poland.
My name is Anton Somers, violin maker, based in Antwerp, Belgium.
My name is Lorenzo Cassi and I'm a violin maker based in Valtidone, Italy.
My name is Gilles Nair, I'm a French bow maker based in Bordeaux.
Sono Davide Sora, sono un liutaio cremonese che lavora a Cremona da ormai quasi 40 anni.
Mi chiamo Ryosuke Ito, sono giappone ma adesso abito a Cremona da 2008.
My name is Anton Somers, violin maker, based in Antwerp, Belgium.
Hello, Anton Somers is our 9th 制琴师合作伙伴。 非常高兴能够邀请他加入到我们的挚友提琴工作室。那么在今天的视频中我们就带大家大概了解一下安东 Somers 的制琴经历以及他的一些制琴风格。 Hello Anton, welcome to the party. You are the nice member of the Bodega dei Amici. I hope you will enjoy with this party.
Well, it's a big honor. It's a very nice family, I think, a very nice group of people you combined, and I'm honored to be part of it.
Thank you so much. It's so strange because when I invite all these partners, it looks like you already know each other.
Well, Piotr is around the same age as me. Mm-hmm. We never met each other in school or whatever, but we knew each other work. Mm-hmm. And I met him in New York. And Uli, the first instrument I saw from Uli was actually at somebody's house, and I was really impressed by the work. It was the first violin I saw from Uli. Mm-hmm. And that got me interested. And then we met each other in Cremona and talked a lot.
Before you, I know nothing about Belgian makers, but just out of the blue, I saw this Anton Somers. It looks so nice. I'm quite picky when I try to find someone. The quality, the personality, the two marks, the full varnish, I love them all. So can you tell us where you start your study and how you developed your personal style?
Yes. Yeah, first of all, thank you for the compliment. But it's really nice that you mention all these things, because that's what I want to present, this kind of things. I started my career as violin maker in a violin making school in Antwerp. I was 16 years old. When I started this school, I wasn't expecting of staying in Belgium. Mm-hmm. I mean, when you start violin making, you expect probably to work somewhere.
Italy, France.
Yeah, or you don't know where you would end up. Mm-hmm. So for me, it's a coincidence. I stayed in Belgium. Mm-hmm. So after school, I got a job in Brussels with a violin maker. And there I learned a lot. I worked there for 6 years in Brussels, and we were only doing new making.
You doing this new making is quite special. I mean, in the Europe city, normally you do a lot like repairing, setup, but yeah. It's just making new instrument for me. It's quite special workshop, right?
Yeah, but it's a decision. I think you have to make, because from the moment you start doing repairs and then doing more selling, I mean you quickly get lost in doing repairs. In my own workshop now, I also made a decision, like I focus actually fully on new making.
New making.
Sometimes it happens you do a repair or restoration, but then you quickly realize like, watch out, because yeah, the focus is on the new making. Like that's all the where the energy has to go.
So. We have so limited time, right?
Yeah, there's only
all the passion in the new making.
Yeah, yeah.
But you have also been teaching in the school.
True.
For how many years?
Well, also for 6 years.
For 6 years, that's so quite long.
Probably I was quite young, actually.
But you're still quite young, right? I mean, Anton is actually younger than me. You're like.
I'm 35 now.
35, yeah. I'm almost 40. You told me you also learn a lot while you are teaching the young makers.
Yeah, that's
very interesting for me, because when you're teaching these young guys, you get inspiration from them.
Yeah, you get inspiration, and you also have to question yourself over and over and over again, because they ask a ton of questions and you have to find an answer. And so it makes you rethink every detail you do on an instrument. Mm. It also develops my style a lot. It made me probably make, that's why I make straight varnish, personal model. I was thinking like when doing copies and all these kind of things, you explain them, but I wanted to go on. Mm-hmm. I wanted to go on with the style, with creating something personal, and that's where it comes from explaining. Yeah.
So. I heard it's two of your students, they are winning the competition in Paris for making the cellos, right?
Yes, that was a nice experience. So
that's a really nice result. As you as teacher, when you saw this young maker, they are starting to build up this confidence in the making.
Yeah, definitely.
I saw this picture when you showing this cello to your student. You look really enjoy the moment.
Yeah.
When you explain it to the young guys.
Yeah, if you teach, you have to do it with passion. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you don't, the students, they also expect.
But talk about yourself. You are not that kind of people really enjoy to be the competition. With competition, you just made it twice, right?
I made twice competition, and I was happy with the results, because I always ended with the last few. Mm-hmm. But it's also this the same decision what you make. It's like the same idea with personal model, everything. It's like also competition. I start questioning it. Well, like, what's a competition? How can you talk about art in competition? Mm-hmm. Because it gets so personal that I don't know if a jury can really understand what. So for me, there was no real value in a competition.
Thanks for Andy to bring us together, and we just saw the quartet you made for Andy. That is quite special. It's you use personal model for all your instruments, like violin, viola, cello. So how did you design your own model?
It's always an evolution. It starts with an idea, and you create it. I pick up different details, and I pick up what I like, and it's not my instruments are still in classical proportions.
Sure.
So there's nothing, if you look at the instruments, it's a normal violin, and it's probably what you can call in a Italian style. When I make the instruments, you already think like, oh, next time I'm gonna change this, or you've seen an antique instrument and you think like, wow, I have to try to
Especially I think for the cello, because we have more than 10 really good cellos. Yes. But after one day of trying this cello made by Anton, for my personal, I really enjoy it. And also we have talking with Andy, who is a professional cellist. So do you have any specific concept about the cello making? You make it a lot, I mean.
Yeah, I make quite a lot of cellos, and I have. And the bass is very important for a cello. It's a combination. It's bass and also the A has to sound good.
May I ask your measurement? What is the distance between the eyehole eye, the other eye?
The upper high. Here it is around 100.
100?
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So, but I also have the space here to do it. I think that's also where it's.
For me, that's a part of the concept. You tried a lot of things on the cello, right?
Yeah.
Do you think the cello gives you more space to play with it?
Yeah, but I know it so much. I know the model perfectly. So I do play with it. Like it also depends on the wood. It depends on the kind of arching I give it. Mm-hmm. Like if I want to have it stiffer, if I want to have it the F-holes, it changes. Mm-hmm. Also the F-hole length or it's not always fixed. Mm. So I do play
a lot.
Play
a lot.
Yeah.
When I'm looking at your instrument, I saw you play a lot with the texture, right? The texture,
yes.
The wood, texture, the varnish.
Yeah, that's part of the whole concept too. I mean, it gives so much, like this more, so much more on the instrument when you look at it. And it starts from the woodwork and it ends up with the varnishing. And it's really everything.
We always trying to tell the customer that the texture, the character, is the very important part for the whole instrument. If we take a look at Ulrich's instrument, Piotr's instrument, and Anton's instrument, we are not going to try to make a perfect violin, but we are trying to show you the true nature from the wood, the texture, the hand of the maker. So when you receive Anton's instrument, you will find some two marks. You will even find his handprint on the varnish because you tap the varnish by the hand. Yeah. So we really enjoy to doing it. I hope our customer will be happy when you see all this sign made from the makers.
Yeah, I think that's what it's all about. We are creating something with our hands.
Yeah.
It's very easy to make it unpersonal. Mm-hmm. That's not so difficult.
Yeah.
But it takes a lot of thinking and what works or not, especially with texture, with tool marks. Like you have to have a clear idea where you would end up with.
But how can you be so successful in the US market?
I think it's meeting the right people. Mm-hmm. Meeting the right people, really particular people. I spend a lot of effort in doing this, and I thought very well about how the market worked and what my position can be in this market. So it's well thought, and
okay. I hope you enjoy the Chinese market.
I hope I will.
But for now, before 2025, we are fully booked. Right?
Yeah.
So I hope after 2025, if you are still in love with Anton's instrument, please stay focused on the Bodega de Amici. And I hope in the future I can bring your cello, your viola to the Chinese market. If I get the honor, maybe I can have a quartet from you, okay?
That would be awesome.
Thank you for joining us.